Good afternoon, and welcome to those of you who have been with us all day, and a fresh welcome to those of you who are just joining us. My name is Louisa Baldini. I'm a former BBC News correspondent, and I'm delighted to be guiding you through today's proceedings, an incredibly important day here, of course, at COP26, Energy Day. This is the final event of the day, so let me just run through what you can expect. We'll begin with opening remarks and announcements by the co-chairs of the Powering Past Coal Alliance and distinguished guests from the International Energy Agency and the United Nations. We will then be hearing from the Alliance's government members, both national and subnational, followed by a discussion amongst PPCA members and partners from the business and financial world. Before I introduce the speakers, though, let's watch a short video highlighting the achievements of the PPCA over the past few years.
Phasing out coal from the electricity sector is the single most important step to get in line with 1.5 degree goal.
I have no doubt that this first PPCA Global Summit is the beginning of a major acceleration of the pace, speed and scale of the transition from coal to clean energy around the world.
Those still investing in coal today are missing out on the opportunity to shape our future.
As we approach COP26, we need countries around the world to continue raising their ambitions in the race to zero emissions, and the Alliance is helping them do just that.
We would like to phase out the lignite-fired blocks of our last remaining coal-fired power plant by 2025.
Having closed coal equals the removal of 7 million cars from the road. Smog days virtually disappeared.
We are convinced that this transition can be a catalyst for new opportunities.
Making a lot of an effort to diversify our energy mix by investing in renewable energy sources, while at the same time opening investment opportunities to foreign investors.
Within the next 10 years, we will transform from almost 100% coal energy mix to 100% renewables.
We are divesting part of our exposure to coal, and at the same time we are doing a lot of engagement with the company we are invested in.
Sri Lanka is happy to be a coal leader of the Energy Compact for no new coal power.
let us now welcome the co-chairs of the Powering Past Coal Alliance, Canadian Minister Stephen Guilbeault and UK Minister Greg Hands. If you could both please take a lectern each. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much indeed. And it's great to be with you to help round off what has been an amazing and productive energy day. As the UK's Energy and Climate Change Minister, it's a huge privilege to see you all gathered here in Glasgow and to hear firsthand about the action countries and non-state actors alike are taking to consign coal to history and make clean energy our future. I was absolutely delighted to take on the role of co-chair of the Powering Past Coal Alliance, an organization at the heart of our green energy transition. There's many organizations in this space, but I have to say this is my personal favorite and my favorite initiative here at COP26 because it's so straightforward and easy to understand. And it builds on the vision of one of my predecessors, who I know is in the hall today, Claire O'Neill. Claire, why not stand up? And I think let's give a round of applause to Claire. And also, I'm told, Catherine McKenna, the Canadian counterpart, she's not in the hall, but she's the co-founder back at COP, I think 3 or 4 years ago in New York, where the UK and Canada got together and said, let's do something about it. It's a great pleasure to be joined by my current Canadian counterpart, Minister Guilbeault, new Environment Minister and co-chair of the Powering Past Coal Alliance. We've expanded from a handful of members to 165 members now. It's an incredible achievement. And it's fantastic to welcome more of you to the Alliance today. I know that the PPCA will be instrumental over the course of the UK's COP26 presidency as the world seeks to scale up deployment of clean power tech, end investment in new coal power generation, phase out coal power, and support a just transition. We've already achieved a lot in a short period of time. The global pipeline of proposed coal power plants has already decreased by 76% since 2015. For our part in the UK, we've reduced the use of coal for electricity down to be incredibly less than 2% of our total usage, and it'll be gone from our energy mix entirely by 2024. But to keep 1.5 degrees in reach, we need to go much further, and we need to go much faster. The International Energy Agency's World Energy Outlook report shows that our currently announced pledges only translate to a 40% reduction in CO2 emissions by 2050. There is more we can do, and both developed and developing countries need to keep working towards the 2030 and 2040 phase-out dates, respectively. Analysis suggests we need to shut down the equivalent of 2 large coal power stations a week globally, 2 large coal-fired power stations a week globally to reach the 2040 target. That figure may seem daunting, but the Alliance is here to support countries to make the change. We also understand the challenges this transition brings, especially for emerging economies who face the risk of stranded assets, and less developed countries who will need greater support. We have seen huge leadership from developing countries who have committed to no new coal. I want to use this platform to invite others to take this first most important step to eradicate coal before the end of this year. Looking to the future, the PPCA is driving forward a new, exciting agenda with fresh priorities. Countries' commitments to ditching coal must be met with significant and sustained support to be achievable. That is why the PPCA is partnering with the Climate Investment Funds, which will bring powerful policy expertise alongside climate finance to help coal-dependent economies make the transition to greener energy sources. We're setting up a series of regional engagement meetings between the CIFs and countries developing investment plans for alternatives to coal. This will enable countries to develop effective clean energy plans. Through this partnership, we will work with countries like South Africa, like Indonesia, India, and the Philippines to support this transition. This is a bold vision to carry the work of the PPCA forward, one which brings together a coalition of countries and stakeholders who are committed to the steps we need to take. We are not an alliance of the already phased out, but one of cooperation between our current members and those we'll hopefully be welcoming soon to rid the world of coal power emissions. I say finally, this is no mean feat. I say standing in a place often referred to as no mean city, Glasgow, but we can get there. We need to strive to meet our objectives collectively and as an alliance. Claire and Catherine chose the alliance word deliberately those years ago. As alliance, we are committed more than ever to support the transition. Let's keep powering the world past coal. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you so much, Craig. Thank you, Louisa. C'est un honneur pour moi d'être ici en tant que ministre canadien de l'Environnement et du Changement climatique et co-président de l'Alliance Powering Past Coal. When I went to the very first COP as a young environmentalist in Berlin in 1995, the idea of a global alliance dedicated to fighting coal would have been considered a radical, a utopian fad. I'm proud to stand here with my co-chair, Craig Hands, on stage of a COP presidency that has put the global transition to clean energy at the top of its agenda. Ending emissions from coal power is one of the single most important steps we must take to meet the goals of the Paris Agreement and the 1.5 degree target in particular. A step that also improves overall public health by creating cleaner, more breathable air. But more than that, Greg and I are here together to send a simple message that coal power phase-out is inevitable. It may seem impossible to talk about this at a time when the world is recovering from the pandemic, and countries, including here in the UK, are suffering from a global energy crunch. Mais ces crises, aussi difficiles soient-elles, nous ont également montré la rapidité avec laquelle nous pouvons nous mobiliser et innover à l'échelle mondiale lorsque les enjeux sont les plus élevés. Cela souligne l'importance de réussir la transition. L'élimination des émissions dues à l'énergie du charbon ne peut se faire au détriment de la sécurité énergétique, de l'accès à l'énergie et de son caractère abordable. Ce processus doit aller de pair et cela représente une énorme opportunité mondiale. The PPCA is a proof that this is achievable. The alliance was launched at COP23, a small alliance, 28 members, lots of high ambition, packed in one small room. I was there as an NGO representative. We have come so far in such short time. And here I should tip my hat, as Craig did, to my predecessor, Catherine McKenna, as well as Jonathan Wilkinson, whose work founding and building the PPCA over the past 4 years has helped to get us where we are. A testimony to the success that is today, alone welcoming another 28 new members to the Alliance, bringing us to more than 160 members from around the world. I'm happy to welcome seven nation states, Chile, Ukraine, Estonia, Slovenia, Mauritius, Azerbaijan, and Singapore, who becomes the first national government member in Asia. And the subnational government, we welcome the Polish city of Wałbrzych and Koszalin, the South African city of Durban, Guimoras, Ormoc City, and Negros Occidental in the Philippines, as well as the US state of New Mexico. L'engagement pris cette année par la Chine, la Corée du Sud et les pays du G7 de mettre fin à tout nouveau financement public pour le charbon thermique a envoyé un signal clair au secteur privé. Si vous n'avez pas de plan de transition pour abandonner le charbon, vous ne prenez pas en compte les risques climatiques pour vos actionnaires. I'm also pleased to welcome several new private sector members, including financial firms such as NatWest, Score Global Investment, and the Ethos Foundation. Ukrainian and Indonesian utilities, DTEC and Indica Energy, And I'm extremely pleased to welcome a number of Canadian firms, including TransAlta Corporation, Vancity, the United Church of Canada, and Export Development Canada, the PPCA's first export-credit agency. We realize that, as we end support for coal projects, countries need support and clean energy financing. C'est pourquoi le Premier ministre canadien a annoncé, il y a trois jours, qu'un milliard de dollars pour l'élimination progressive du charbon et la transition vers des énergies propres serait alloué au Fonds d'investissement climatique. Aujourd'hui, je suis heureux d'annoncer que nous nous associons au Fonds en tant que nouveau partenaire stratégique de l'Alliance Powering Past Coal. The phase-out is underway in Canada. We are committed to ending export of coal, thermal coal, and phasing out conventional coal-fired electricity no later than 2030, while supporting coal workers and their communities through the transition to cleaner energy. And Canada is pleased to help others plan their transition. We have our work cut out for us. It won't be easy, but it is necessary. Thank you. Merci.
Thank you very much, co-chairs, for your remarks. I would like to now invite Dr. Fatih Birol, Executive Director of the International Energy Agency, to please, if you could go to the lectern there at the left of the stage. Thank you very much. Just last week, Time magazine wrote, "When Birol speaks, energy companies and policymakers around the world listen." Dr. Fatih Birol.
Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to all of you. Before talking about coal, if I may, I would like to share a very good news for all of us, especially for our COP presidents, which is the following. We all follow the discussions before COP, and there was a lot of pessimism, skepticism, whether or not this COP will at all deliver something. Now, what we have seen in the last few days, after months of work of several diplomats, COP presidency, lots of pledges, one after another. Countries committing themselves for 2050 or around 2050 net zero. Also during the COP, we have seen India and some other countries made commitments. Plus, a very important commitment of over 100 countries to reduce methane emissions. So what is the news? News is the following. I asked my colleagues in Paris to calculate if all these pledges were to be implemented, including the methane emissions, what is the temperature increase the world would experience? The answer is the following. If all these pledges were to be implemented, the temperature increase could be limited to 1.8 degrees Celsius. I think this is a very well-celebrated achievement. Greg, to you and the others, congratulations. I will congratulate you more after in about 9 days, but for the time being, a preliminary congratulations. Dear colleagues, when it comes to coal, congratulations both the co-presidents here and their predecessor. Now we have two problems here. Problem number one, not to build new coal plants, which was explained by several colleagues that the appetite is not so big. But the other problem, for me the blind spot of the coal debate is, what are we going to do with the existing stock? According to the numbers of the International Energy Agency, if the coal power plants in the world we have now would continue to run in line with their normal economic lifetimes, they will eat up half of the budget we have to reach 1.5 degrees Celsius target. Alone, they will eat up half of the budget. So therefore, a big challenge is phasing out the existing coal plants around the world, in addition to the discourage to build new ones. And here, there are many discussions. I would like to pinpoint two issues. Number one, phase-out policies should be well-designed to see what would be the implications on electricity security and the prices. Otherwise, you may well hear, once again, misport rate claims that, for example, as we hear now, current high prices is as a result of clean energy transitions, which is completely wrong. But again, not to give room for such speculations, electricity security and prices in the well-designed phase-out policies have the priority. Number two, and this is very important for me, coal phase-out in poor countries and rich countries are completely two different issues. I cannot put a rich country with only a few percentage of coal share in their generation with a poor country with a huge reliance on coal, not only in terms of generation, but in terms of employment. So therefore, I hope this initiative will keep an eye and support the phase-out strategies in developing countries in many respects, including the financial support. I thank you very much.
Dr. Fatih Birol there, thank you very much indeed. And now to the Special Advisor to the UN Secretary General on Climate Action, Selwyn Hart. If you could take to the microphone, thank you very much. Selwyn has served in several important climate change leadership positions leading to his appointment at the UN last year. Selwyn.
Thank you so much. Distinguished co-chairs, excellencies, pleasure to join you here this afternoon. And what started just a few years ago as a coalition of the willing has now become an unstoppable movement. In just a few years, we have come very far in our push to move the world from coal to clean and to accelerate a just transition that leaves no one behind. The G20 as a whole has decided to end international coal finance this year. This decision will have many important effects. The world's largest financiers of coal have announced that they will no longer back these projects, and we hope to see them more and more engaged in supporting renewable energy projects in the developing world. We now need all G20 countries to commit to phase out coal based on the science, OECD countries by 2030 and globally by 2040. And we need private banks, primarily, and other financial institutions, primarily in the United States, in Europe, and the Asia Pacific region, to end their support for coal. We must see no new coal-fired power plants built in 2022. And we can't over-rely on unproven solutions or move into other fossil fuels that will create more stranded assets, in particular when alternatives, renewable energies, are proven to be healthier, faster to build, and cheaper. And we can and must rely on coalitions of governments, donors, and yes, the renewable energy private sector, banding together to support developing countries that are ready to phase out coal. It is only through true international cooperation that we will get the concrete and ambitious results that we need. And many governments, developed and developing countries, can bring something to the table, from technical capacities to financial instruments. And developing countries will require support, solid support, to accelerate the transition and ensure that the transition is fair and just. And we have seen important examples. The energy transition partnership that was announced between South Africa and a group of countries, including Germany, France, the UK, and the US. This partnership will allow South Africa to rapidly decommission its coal plants while addressing the needs of workers and communities of the sectors that who cannot be left behind. And we need to see this replicated and repeated across the world, including in places like Indonesia. And we heard the distinguished minister, Sri Mulani, yesterday indicate that Indonesia was ready to end its use of coal with international support. We also welcome today's statement on international support for the clean energy transition. And while we see in this statement that some MDBs are stepping up, multilateral development banks are stepping up, tragically, too many MDBs are under-delivering on climate action. And we are facing a climate emergency. All stakeholders, including the MDBs, must be on an emergency footing. It is time for you, the shareholders of these institutions, especially the developed nations who are major owners, to step in and urgently change the direction of travel of these institutions who have a critical role to play in the fight against the climate crisis. The Secretary General has made it clear the UN is ready to stand by you. The Power and Pass Coal Alliance has done a great job so far, and I encourage all its members to continue working together, supporting each other, and reaching out to others to join. But our fight is far from over. Fatih, I heard your numbers, but based on the NDCs that have been submitted, the world is on a 2.7 degree pathway, a catastrophic pathway. And therefore, we are a long way away from keeping the 1.5 degree goal of the Paris Agreement alive. We cannot be complacent. We cannot celebrate before we've done the job. So even today, as we celebrate our success, this is a fight we cannot afford. We must recognize that this is a fight we cannot afford to lose. I urge all of you to keep up the fight. I thank you.
Mr. Selwyn-Hart, thank you very much indeed. I just want to check that everybody's okay. There seems to be a medical emergency. So if we could just take pause at just while we just check on our guest. If you could just remain, thank you. Okay, so we're just going to pause for a few moments. If everybody could please stay in the seats while the emergency services are dealing with the situation. And in the meantime, I just want to thank our speakers very much indeed. I know, Fatih, you've got to rush off. So thank you very much, all of you, for your words. Thank you for your time. Thank you very much indeed for your patience. I understand that the person who is taken ill is now okay, but they are receiving medical treatment. But we can continue now. We have been so fortunate in the amazing speakers and participants who have been able to join us today. But not everybody could be here in person. So we're going to be watching a video now where we're going to be hearing from a new PPCA member, Singapore, and existing member, Israel.
Partners of the Powering Past Coal Alliance, greetings from Singapore. It is clear to all of us that the burning of coal is putting billions of people at immediate risk. This is why Singapore has decided to join the Powering Past Coal Alliance today, one of the first countries in Asia to do so. Singapore's membership to the PPCA expresses our long-term commitment to clean energy and tangible climate action. We have been an early move in the shift away from coal. The fact is that our reliance on coal has been marginal since the days of our early independence in the 60s. Since the start of the century, we shifted almost entirely to cleaner natural gas for power generation. Today, coal makes up less than 2% of our power generation capacity. We intend to do better. As part of our energy reset, we are putting solar panels on our rooftops and reservoirs. As a small island nation, we have limited options to deploy renewable energy at scale. We are pursuing the importation of clean energy and investing in clean energy R&D, such as hydrogen. We are fully committed to accelerate the transition to a low carbon future in support of the goals of the Paris Agreement. We will continue to nurture the growth of our clean energy companies. This will also support the energy transition for the countries in our region and contribute to new economic opportunities. We are working with financial institutions to develop a vibrant green finance ecosystem to support Asia's transition towards greater sustainability. Through this alliance, we look forward to forging new collaborations and contributing to global climate action. We look forward to working with you closely.
I would like to begin by saying a big thank you to the Powering Past Coal Alliance for all you do in raising awareness of the need to advance transition from unvetted coal power generation to clean energy. The State of Israel has been a proud member of the PPCA since 2018, and we don't like to wait around. Immediately, we set about creating a national energy plan to cease all the use of coal by 2025, while maximizing renewable energy use. However, in recent months, we have further increased our commitment towards a clean Israeli energy sector by 2030. We are hoping to complete a successful transition from polluting fuels to clean energy and align Israel with other developed countries in the global fight against climate crisis. Recently, we drafted a strategy focused on generating electricity from renewable energy, on increasing energy efficiency, and on promoting a total transition to electric transportation. As a direct result of this newfound urgency, the Israeli government has been updating its greenhouse gas emission reduction targets. This is our commitment to the path that the PPCA lays out and to greener, more sustainable future for all humanity. Thank you.
And we are now going to hear from some of the new members who are with us here today. First, I'd like to invite Chilean Minister Juan Carlos Jobet to speak. I think if all the mics here on the table on the desk are working, we can maybe stay here if that's any easier, or would you prefer the lectern?
It's fine from here. It's easier for everyone. Well, thanks, everyone. Hello. I want to celebrate the UK and Canada's leadership on this cause. Chile is very proud to join the Powering Past Coal Alliance. To comply with its aims is a big challenge for us, but we are doing our homework. We currently generate around 40% of our electricity with coal, and coal plants have played an essential role in our economic growth over the last couple of decades. It provided a reliable source of base load power and was cheap. That has been the logic behind it. But at some point, we realized we couldn't follow that logic any longer. Because you know what? The truth is, the small price of coal is really a big lie. Because we only pay part of it and leave the rest unpaid as a ticking bomb for future generations. So in 2018, we started a dialogue with all relevant stakeholders, public officials, NGOs, workers, companies, experts, local communities. And after more than a year, we reached an agreement. We agreed to end new coal development and to phase out all our coal capacity no later than 2040. And we're working to make that happen by 2030. And we're making good progress. We have closed 25% of our plants and have pledges to decommission or reconvert 65% of our capacity by 2025. To replace coal, we are developing our unique renewable capacity. To give you a sense, this year only, we will build 6 gigawatts of solar PV and wind capacity, actually doubling our solar and wind capacity in just 1 year in spite of the pandemic. We have other challenges as well on system flexibility, building transmission infrastructure, and very important, making sure that the phase-out plan leaves no one behind. It's not going to be easy, but it is possible, even for a small developing country like Chile. And it's the right thing to do. We feel confident that with the right set of policies, business creativity, and international collaboration, we will make it happen. Thank you.
Minister Hobbit, thank you very much indeed. And I understand you have to leave us. So thank you so much. We appreciate you making time to be here with us today. Thank you very much indeed. And next, we're going to hear from Minister Jernej Vrtovec from Slovenia's Ministry of Infrastructure. Slovenia has made ambitious climate action a key priority to its presidency of the EU.
Thank you very much, Your Excellencies, dear ministers, colleagues and friends. I have come here today not only as a representative of Slovenia, but first and foremost as a husband and a father. And I have just one simple message. It's best embodied by thought coming from a book that the majority of us knows probably very well. As for the future, our task is not to foresee it, but to enable it. In 2015, we have agreed on our vision, and we have agreed to strengthen the global response to the threat of climate change. In 2018, the science warned us that the 2-degree scenario could lead to significant and potentially catastrophic changes to the planet. In 2021, ladies and gentlemen, it's a high time to act. Now, dear colleagues, now. We have to invest our best efforts to phase out coal in the most ambitious manner. We are all aware that this will be a challenging journey. Namely, Slovenia has built a new thermal power plant in 2014. It should be in operation by 2054. Power generation coming from the use of coal represents 1/3 of our electricity mix. Deciding on an ambitious coal phase-out date, economic restructuring of Slovenia's two coal regions, and ensuring just transition for all affected will be an enormous challenge for us. But, ladies and gentlemen, Slovenia has accepted the challenge. It's going to be extremely difficult for all involved, for people and the economy. But nevertheless, we shall phase out coal by early 2030s at latest. As for the future, our task is not to foresee it, but to enable it. Thank you.
Minister Vrtvec of Slovenia, thank you very much indeed. And next we will hear from Irina Stavchuk, Deputy Minister of Environmental and Environmental Protection and Natural Resources from Ukraine. Ukraine is committed to ending coal power and is working to make this transition.
Thank you, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. Good afternoon to all of you. On behalf of the government of Ukraine, I'm really delighted to announce that Ukraine joins Fast Coal Alliance with a target to phase out coal in the electricity sector by 2035. The last year has been a tremendous shift in the Ukrainian climate policies. We have approved updated NDC after many, many calculations and many difficult discussions with energy sector, industry sector, and with other ministries. And we took the target to reduce emissions by 65% from 1990 level by 2030. And of course, energy sector is the biggest share and sector where the most of emissions have to be reduced. Over the last year, also major businesses in Ukraine, energy and steel, also took the targets for getting to climate neutrality. So this is a joint action of the government, and we also see it in the business. 30% of energy still comes in Ukraine from coal. And we plan to move to decarbonize the sector through development of renewable energies, through development of new balancing capacities, through integration to EU electricity system. This objective will not be easy. Ukraine has a quite difficult situation with energy poverty. Many people cannot afford paying their bills. So all the carbon pricing and all the modernization has to come with many difficulties. We also have coal regions in transition when we have to develop social programs and make sure that transformation will not leave behind those people who live in those cities. But we also understand that we don't have any other way for development, and we have to modernize energy sector based on renewables, based on new technologies, and on much stronger energy efficiency. And we are looking forward to working with all of you on this way. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Irina Stavchuk of Ukraine. And next, let's hear from Estonia, which is already coal-free and will help to strengthen the alliance's presence in the EU. So from Estonia, Ms. Kadi Riskok, head of the Climate Department from Estonia's Ministry of Environment.
Thank you. Dear partners of the Powering Past Coal Alliance, ladies and gentlemen, Estonia has set climate issues as its priority, and we are fully committed to meeting the goal of climate neutrality by 2050. While Estonia does not have coal, we also have had a difficult starting point. Our energy sector, our economy, was almost completely dependent on our national fossil fuel, oil shale. And in our green transition, we have already reduced greenhouse gas emissions by more than 70% since 1990. We have taken important steps, of course, in the development of solar and wind energy over the past 15 years. And we plan to stop producing oil shale-based electricity by 2035 and switch to renewable electricity sources. We plan to completely phase out oil shale-based energy by 2040. This kind of transition out of fossil fuels, especially coal, is needed, of course, globally. And we know the effects that burning solid fossil fuels has on our planet, and we know that low-carbon energy solutions are the future. It is important, therefore, to have clear goals on the energy transition to offer clarity to our citizens and our industry. This is the only way to have a just transition, and we are fully committed to do that. Thank you very much.
Kadri Viskok from Estonia, thank you very much indeed. I'd like now to invite Minister Kavidas Romano here on behalf of Mauritius. As a small island state, Mauritius is on the front lines of climate impacts and is therefore committed to phase out coal by 2030.
Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I'm pleased on behalf of Mauritius to be part of this Powering Post-Coal Alliance event to accelerate the global phase-out of emissions from coal power. As we are all aware, the 1.5 degrees Celsius is worryingly close. Extreme climatic events all over the globe are harsh reminders that we are in a state of climate emergency. As recommended by the Secretary General of the United Nations, all countries should declare a state of climate emergency until the world reaches net zero carbon dioxide emissions. Climate change is a topmost priority for the government of Mauritius. Being among the most vulnerable countries, according to the World Risk Report, the Republic of Mauritius has joined the coalition of countries in declaring a state of emergency. Despite its insignificant contribution to the global greenhouse gas emissions of the order of 0.01%, a more ambitious NDC to achieve greenhouse gas emissions reduction by 40% by 2030 has been submitted. This target will be achieved through audacious measures as follows. First, 60% of green energy in the energy mix by 2030. Second, complete phase out of coal by 2030. Third, development of a national biomass framework on alternatives to coal. Fourth, the implementation of the electric vehicle integration roadmap. Fifth, achievement of a target of 100% renewable energy in Rodrigues Island within the next two decades. And last but not least, a long-term strategy for the energy sector is being developed under the Facilité 2050 initiative. It is along this line that I am pleased to announce that Mauritius is joining the Powering Post-Coal Alliance. I wish to also inform that Mauritius is also supporting the Global Coal to Clean Power Transition Statement, the Statement on Public Support for the Clean Energy Transition, as well as the Global Green Grids Initiative, One Sun, One World, One Grid. The implementation of most of these actions form part of the Mauritius NDC, for which partnership with the local private sectors, as well as support from the international communities, would be required. As a concluding note, we believe that with bold and timely measures by all parties, it is still possible to keep the crucial 1.5 degrees Celsius target alive. With these words, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you all for your kind attention.
Mr. Kavidas Romano from Mauritius, thank you very much indeed. And thank you to all those new PPCA members we've just heard from. But we are also joined by some of the Alliance's existing members who play an important role, of course, in driving the coal phase-out discussion. So let's hear now from some of them. First, could you please welcome His Royal Highness Prince Jaime de Bourbon de Parma, Climate Envoy of the Netherlands. The Netherlands has been a member of the Alliance from the beginning and has continued to be one of the most active members since. The Royal Highness.
Thank you very much, Chair. Now, the Netherlands is a very proud member of PPCA. 2 years ago, we passed a law to phase out coal. From 2030 onwards, it will be completely prohibited to produce electricity from coal in the Netherlands. So there's no way back. Now, what is great about PPCA is that its members can achieve so much more by working together in a coalition. By speaking together, our voices are louder. And let's be very loud today. And I'm very happy to welcome the new voices, Chair, as you said today, that are sitting here next to me. And we have people, we have government members joining us. Some have already spoken. We have new sub-national members, and we have the private sector members. All of you are most welcome. I want to focus my contribution today on finance. We all have agreed to bring financial flows in line with the Paris Agreement. In addition to phasing out coal from energy mix, we must seize new investment in coal-fired power and boost investments in clean energy, domestic and abroad. This is what the PPCA Financial Task Force is trying to achieve. Now, we have received some encouraging signs recently, including through the G20, committing to end government support for overseas coal-fired power by the end of this year. But stopping private finance for coal power and technology is at least as important. And I'm very happy to report that several major financial institutions signed the PPCA financial principles earlier this year. This means that they commit to stop financing for new coal power plants. And the signatories include ABP, which is also my own pension fund. And this is the fifth largest pension fund in the world, with about 500 billion in assets. And just last week, ABP actually set a next important step in order to align its investments with the Paris Agreement goals. ABP announced that it will divest from all fossil fuels. And I feel very, very encouraged by this news, and yes, an applause is more than welcome. Others in the financial sector should follow this example to ensure they reach the goals of aligning all financial flows with Paris. Lastly, I would like to emphasize that we cannot only divest from coal, we must also invest in clean energy. International cooperation is crucial in setting up enough clean energy. And the Dutch government, for example, cooperates with developing countries on renewable energy projects. And through these projects, around 10 million people have gained access to clean energy since 2015. Welcome to all the new members, and I look forward to working together. Thank you very much.
Prince Jaime de Bourbon de Parma from the Netherlands. Thank you very much indeed. Next, we will hear from Minister Azucena Arbeláez of Uruguay, which joined the Alliance in March this year at the first ever PPCA summit. Uruguay is a leader in building a coal-free electricity sector, producing more than 97% of its electricity from renewable energy sources. Minister.
Thank you. Good afternoon. At the beginning of this century, Uruguay's electricity sector was heavily dependent on hydroelectric power generation. Having no proven reserves of oil, natural gas, or coal, in years with low rainfall, we needed to import costly electricity or fossil fuels to make supply meet demand. During the last decade, Uruguay implemented different instruments to promote private investment in wind energy. As a result, We now generate 97% of our electricity from renewable sources, around 50% hydroelectric energy, 30% wind energy, 15% biomass, and 3% solar. As we move from the pandemic response to economic recovery, Uruguay started what we call our second energy transition. Its main drivers are the substitution of fossil sources in those areas with available technology. One area of the second energy transition are electric vehicles. Economic incentives fostered a 100% increase in the number of electric vehicles sold in the first semester of this year compared to the same semester of last year. In addition, we continue working on a strategy to replace diesel-powered public buses with electric ones, based on incentives to purchase new units and expansion of the chargers network. Another area of this second energy transition is hydrogen, where we are now close to announce our national strategy. Moreover, we are working on our first pilot project for heavy-duty transport based on green hydrogen. Finally, supported by the availability of renewable sources, the country's institutional framework, and respect for the rule of law, its favorable treatment to investors, whether it's national or foreign, we can potentially reach very competitive prices. This may allow us to become an exporter of hydrogen and its derivatives, such as green fuels for the marine and aviation sector. To conclude, it is safe to say that Uruguay is one of the top renewable energy users in the world. In spite of this, we are preparing for our second energy transition in order to continue our provision of global public goods and more specifically, fulfill the objectives included in our long-term climate strategy. Thank you.
Minister Arbeláez of Uruguay, thank you very much indeed. And finally, North Macedonia became a member of the alliance in June of this year. North Macedonia submitted an enhanced NDC to the Paris Agreement earlier this year, committing to 51% emission cuts by 2030 compared to 1990 levels. It's an ambitious target for a country that gets around half of its power from burning lignite. So I'd now like to call on North Macedonia's representative here today, Minister of Environment and Physical Planning, Nasser Nuradini.
Thank you. Good afternoon to all, dear colleagues, dear ministers. As you mentioned, exactly our new NDC, which was submitted this year, when bearing that in mind and we segregated by sector, it equates to approximately 66% reduction in the energy sector. It is safe to say that the climate challenge, to a large extent, is in essence a clean energy challenge. And this is planned to be achieved in our country mainly through the decommissioning of our two coal-fired power plants by 2027 or latest by 2030. It is important to note that at the moment, as mentioned, up to 60% of our country's electricity generation is coming from these plants. Hence why we are making a lot of effort to diversify our energy mix by investing in renewable energy sources as a country, such as solar and wind, and we are successfully attracting private investments as well, and exploring other alternative energy sources and also looking to solve the storage question. However, we cannot forget that the fact that the transition to green energy needs to be a just transition. It is estimated that our enhanced NDC would create approximately 8,000 new green jobs in the coming decade. Still, as all of the other countries who have been heavily relying on coal, we do have to work on the proper reallocation of our labor, requalification of our workforce, and strengthening the absorption capacity of our private sector. We are aware that the powering past coal and transition towards a carbon-neutral Europe needs to be just with no one left behind, and alliances like this one helps us cooperate in achieving a smoother and faster transition to cleaner energy sources, especially for the countries that share the same historic reliance on coal. I'm very glad to see that we have developed and developing countries on board, and I hope that these discussions will translate into the action that we urgently need to be able to reach the global climate targets. And if I may make a reference to the Executive Director, Birol, from earlier, I would like to reiterate that for developing countries like mine that are committing themselves to phase out coal, not just because we think it's necessary, everyone else is doing it, because we believe in it, and in order to manage a successful just transition, the support by the developed countries is an imperative for our success. Thank you very much and for your attention.
Nasser Nouradini from North Macedonia, thank you very much indeed. And thank you to all of you government representatives who have joined us here to speak today. Thank you. If I could just ask you to remain in your seats for a few more minutes while I introduce the next video, please. Now, just as we heard from a few countries who were unable to join us in person earlier, we're now going to be hearing from the newest subnational governments of the Alliance, including cities and regions in Poland and the Philippines.
My name is Roman Szewemej. I am a mayor of a city of Wałbrzych of a population of 110,000 inhabitants. For more than 500 years, Wałbrzych had been known as a coal mining center. Now, we are on the brink of a climate breakdown, but still, we can save people and the nature from the worst impacts of a climate change. Coal power has been a single largest source of a global temperature increase. Poland is one of the most coal-dependent countries in Europe. Now we join the PPCA to move from the coal to clean energy. I represent not only the population and people of Wałbrzych, but also 52 communities located around Wałbrzych in southern part of Lower Silesia region. By signing a decarbonization 2030 declaration in 2019, we committed ourselves to eliminate the coal as a source of heat and energy in 2030. It would require good planning, determination, and funds, but we are convinced that we can reach the goal in 2030. Thank you very much for inviting me to this Congress, and I wish you a good discussion during the Congress. Thank you very much.
Guimaras as an island province is vulnerable to natural disasters, which are intensified by the increase in global temperature. The island is also susceptible to the threat of human-induced hazard, such as oil spill, as the main navigational routes in the country. Guimaras province adopted the integrated coastal management as the key developmental strategy to ensure a healthy environment as we move towards becoming the agri-ecotourism capital of Western Visayas. As member of PMCN Network of Local Government, or PNLG, we adhere into its framework achieving international target. We have opened our borders to investing organizations that promote renewable energy, which has led to the declaration of Guimaras as the first coal-free province in the Visayas in 2018. Our island homes the 54-megawatt wind farm in the municipality of San Lorenzo, the first ever in Western Visayas to translate the commitments in the coal-free declaration into local legislations. Provisions in the 2020 Guimaras Environment Code states that energy provider using fossil fuel shall not be established within the province, and to promote renewable energy, we are deeply honored to be given the opportunity to become an active member of the Powering Past Coal Alliance, PPCA. With this, we officially accept this invitation and commit to the PPCA goals expressed in the PPCA declaration.
Now, as the co-chairs noted in their opening remarks, the PPCA is not just a group of governments. It also brings together a wide range of utilities, financial organizations, and other private organizations. And I'm now joined by some of those members and partners to hear from them the role that the private sector can and should play in driving the energy transition. So I'm going to be putting a question to each of the guests here on our panel, starting with Dr. Céline Herwire, Group Chief Executive of HSBC, who have joined the Alliance today. Dr. Céline Herwire, what is the role of a global bank like HSBC in addressing the coal challenge then?
Thanks very much. I think I've just been promoted because I'm Group Chief Sustainability
Officer.
Have
I called you?
But all good, all good. So first of all, thank you very much and Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, it's great to be here. I'm really delighted to be able to announce that HSBC is joining the PPCA. We absolutely recognize the importance of the finance sector playing their role in this challenge. I think all of you will have seen Finance Day yesterday and the brilliant news around the volume of assets under management, 130 trillion now committed to net zero before 2050. I think at HSBC, we recognize that we need to tackle the hard issues head on in that transition. And that includes coming in and tackling the transition from coal to clean energy head on as well. We have a unique responsibility as HSBC. We're a 150 something year old bank. We have 3 trillion of assets under management. And we have a long and rich history from east to west and a very kind of heavy presence in emerging markets. And we're absolutely committed to making this transition in partnership with our clients, energy companies around the world, and helping them think about helping them finance that transition that they have ahead. We've actually had a policy in place since 2018, which has prohibited the financing of new coal development and expansion. But this year at our AGM, we passed a special resolution on climate change, which also was proposed by the HSBC board and a number of our shareholders and had the backing votes of 99% of those shareholders. And it includes a commitment to phase out the financing of coal-fired power and thermal coal mining by 2030 in the EU and in the OECD, and by 2040 in all other markets. We were hoping to release the implementation details of this policy in a number of weeks so you can all have a look at the detail. But as a bit of an early snapshot, it will include targets, short-term targets for financed emissions. So it's not just a cliff edge at 2030 and a cliff edge at 2040. You will see that managed decline rapidly in that portfolio of financed emissions. We also, as a key mechanism for implementation, will have client transition plans at the heart of that. So we'll be engaging and asking all of our clients in this segment to disclose their transition plans, and we will be looking to do enhanced due diligence and verify that they are in line with those phase-out dates and more broadly with a net zero 2050 target. We recognize our footprint doesn't make this easy. We have, as I mentioned, a very strong presence in emerging markets that are heavily coal reliant. Many of these markets, India, Philippines, Indonesia, China, 60% or so at the moment reliant on coal energy in their energy mix. And this can't change overnight. And we will be working hard to make this adjustment an orderly transition and make sure that we think about decarbonization and energy security hand in hand. As part of that, we've also signed up to a number of other things. So we've signed up to the WEF Just and Urgent Energy Transition Principles, which include working on innovative early transition mechanisms and public-private mechanisms in that space, and investing in just transition programs, including upskilling and reskilling of communities. We recognize that a massive investment in clean infrastructure is needed. We know the value of $2 trillion a year is needed for clean infrastructure in emerging economies. At HSBC, we've made our own pledge to unlock $1 trillion of finance by 2030 for this transition, which will include a heavy component in emerging economies to help with that. But we also do call on the public sector to help with that. We do need credit enhancement of those projects in emerging economies to be able to go from the billions to the trillions of investment. So I think that's it. I think, you know, the wrap up is we are delighted to be here, as part of this coalition. We hope to be welcoming more of our peers in the private sector space. We've got NatWest here today, which is great. We recognize this needs to happen with urgency. And we're really looking forward to playing our part in this transition. So thank you again, ladies and gentlemen.
Celine Herwire from HSBC, thank you very much for outlining everything, all the work being done there at HSBC in addressing the coal challenge. Next, let's hear from Mafalda Duarte, the CEO of the Climate Investment Funds, which is one of the world's largest and most ambitious multilateral climate finance mechanisms. Mafalda, today it's been announced that the Climate Investment Funds will partner with the PPCA. How do you see this collaboration evolving, and how do you think you'll work together in some of the key target countries that span across both your work and that of the Alliance?
Thank you very much. And first of all, I would like to congratulate the UK government and Canadian government for their leadership in this PPCA. It's already a number of years that this Powering Past Coal Alliance has been established, and I think it has played a critical role in building the political momentum that we are now witnessing, with so many countries, subnational entities, private sector entities actually committing to phasing to goals of phasing out from coal. It's extraordinary because, as we've heard during the day today from many speakers, we are targeting the single largest source of GHG emissions, so the single largest contributor to climate change. And it has to have a key role, a key place in this energy transition reform that we are all aspiring for. Today is, as you said as well, not just we are joining the PPCA, but we launched officially our new investment program, Accelerating Coal Transition Investment Program. This is an ambitious program. We will start off by supporting four countries, South Africa, Indonesia, India, and Philippines. We are bringing public capital, scarce public capital, at quite a reasonable scale into these countries, to not just credit enhance the investments, as Celine was referring to, but also work on two other critical components, which are the governance, so the policy and the regulations and the institutional frameworks to enable this transition, but also the just transition agenda, so the people and communities, and really work across levels of government and with the private sector to make sure that we don't leave these communities and these people behind. And this will involve, of course, diversity of investments, not just in terms of skills development, social protection, but also generating new economic opportunities. So we very much, we have been working for a number of years in this program. We are quite pleased to be able to bring it to fruition now, to start engaging in these countries, and very much look forward to benefiting from this alliance, PPCA, to collaborate with other institutions that are part of the alliance in helping us succeed in these countries, learning from experiences of other countries, be able to share our own experiences as we move forward and support these countries. So that's very much our goal and aspiration. So we are really delighted to be part of this community of champions of this agenda. Thank you.
Mafalda Duarte, the CEO of the Climate Investment Funds and new PPCA partners. Next, let's hear from Ignacio Escalan, from the chairman and CEO of Iberdrola, a major utility based in Spain. Iberdrola is a pioneer in the energy transition and one of the first companies to join this Powering Past Coal Alliance. Mr. Galán, based on your own experience, what is now needed, do you think, to accelerate decarbonization while maximizing opportunities offered by green economies?
So thank you very much. I think we are in a crucial moment if we would like to reach the net zero by 2050. And my message is very clear. We can do it, but we need already to stop talking and start acting. We need already to move fast from fossil fuels to renewables. And investment in energy transition need to be multiplied by 3 times. Our track record, the track of Iberdrola, is a good example. We were the first mover 20 years ago, transforming our company from a traditional utility based in Spain at the time into one of the 3 or 4 largest worldwide, with presence in more than 40 countries. We closed 17 coal and oil power plants, and we have already invested $150 billion in clean energies. By the way, the last chimneys of our coal power plant are being demolished those days, including Longannet, which is the largest power plant in the UK. So it's going to be demolished in the next few days. So here in Scotland, which is our subsidiary, is Scottish Power, we closed this largest coal power plant with no negative impact, social impact at all. And we had invested, meantime, billions in onshore and offshore wind networks and storage. Now, I'm very proud to say that Scotland is not relying any longer on coal. It's a world leader in renewables, and hundreds of local companies are benefiting from the boom of offshore wind. In the world now, we sustain over 400,000 jobs. We have already transformed companies from declining sectors like shipyards into leading manufacturers of offshore wind components. At the same time, we are offering competitive prices for industries, households, as renewable are already today cheaper than any another generation technology. And at the same time, we are reducing emissions, improving air quality and protecting biodiversity. Today, our emission is 1/7 of our European peers, less than 50 grams per megawatt hour. Also, we are already becoming much larger than we were. Our plan is to continue investing heavily. Our plan is to invest $180 billion in this decade, doubling the actual levels to reach zero emission by 2030. 20 years ahead of European peers in targets. We have the technology, the skill, the access to financial resources. So what we need? First, current and stable regulatory frameworks. We are investing for 40, 50 years with the standard power plan. The second is respecting the rule of law in all the countries. We need to end subsidies for fossil fuels and provide price signal based on the principle who pollutes pay. And we need, very important, to accelerate permitting processes for green projects. In some cases, the permitting takes 5 to 7 years when the construction of a power plant takes 18 months. It's our duty to leave a cleaner, more sustainable planet to future generations. And we can do it now, thanks to the electrification with clean energies, smart networks, and storage. Thank you very much.
Some very ambitious targets and commitments there. Thank you very much, Ignacio Escalan from Iberdrola. Now, I'd like to turn to Mairead Lavery, President and CEO at Export Development Canada, which today became the first export credit agency to join the PPCA. Mairead, could you tell us a bit about the work you've been doing, please, and the role that export credit agencies can play in advancing coal phase-out?
Thank you and good afternoon, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be with you today. I would say in very simple terms, we started with being concerned with the question of how do we put an end to coal before coal puts an end to our planet. And it's really at the heart of the mission of the Powering Past Coal Alliance and the reason that we joined, because we're very proud that we can actually collaborate to understand how we can put an end to coal. We look forward to sharing our experience and our knowledge as Canada's Export Credit Agency and as a representative of the Canadian government's long-standing and determined efforts to address the climate challenge facing all of us. So over the last few years, Export Development Canada has been making many choices to put a focus on climate action. Our decision on coal was made 6 years ago. In 2015, Export Development Canada became the first ECA to restrict support to coal-fired power plants, mining, and related coal infrastructure. And we've been working since then actively to help other international partners and peers come to the same conclusion that we did. In fact, today, I would like to challenge my peer ECAs to also sign up to the PPCA to bring transparency to their actions and to their intentions. Coal, however, is only one of the areas where we've been taking action. We also needed to make choices on the support that we provide and where we invest. One of our most high-profile choices was regarding our response and our support to the clean technology industry in Canada and to renewables. Over 10 years ago, we made that a corporate priority. And I'm very proud to say that so far we have financed over $13.5 billion of Canadian clean technology exports. And just $4.5 billion of that was in 2020, illustrating just how the speed is increasing that we see clean technology adoption throughout the world. In 2014, we actually made another marker, becoming the first Canadian financial institution and the world's first ECA to issue a green bond. Today, we have three outstanding green bonds supporting over 20 climate-related transactions, which have the impact of preventing more than 6 million tons of CO2 emissions. And just in 2018, we also aligned with the recommendations of the Task Force on Climate-Related Financial Disclosure, making us the first ECA to take on that disclosure and bringing more rigor to the scientific measuring and management of our corporate carbon footprint and those of our exporters. Transparency has become a watchword at Export Development Canada. In 2019, we released our first target to reduce financing to our carbon-intense sectors, and we announced a target of 15%. I'm happy to say that we achieved that way ahead of our initial 2023 deadline, and as a result, have increased our target to a 40% reduction. Now, I've mentioned a number of firsts that we're very proud of at Export Development Canada, but that's not what should preoccupy us today, because the measure that matters most is not which one of us is first, but when will the last of us join the efforts that are needed? When will we accomplish these things together? Of course, how we do that is the crucial question, and I hope that joining PPCA that we will be closer to answering that question. For that reason, this conference and our own participation at Glasgow should not be seen as an end point. It must rather be seen as a starting place, a springboard to engage others in creating a cleaner, sustainable, low-carbon economy. Thank you again for this opportunity to speak about the critical steps we all can take to drive climate action. Thank you.
Thank you, Mairead, for summarising the role export credit agencies can play. Thank you very much, Mairead Lavery, there. Next, we have a very special guest, Claire O'Neill, who played a key role in launching this very alliance 4 years ago, along with Catherine McKenna from Canada. Claire O'Neill is now the Managing Director of Climate and Energy at the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. Ms. O'Neill, welcome back to the PPCA stage. I'd love to hear what role you think businesses like the WBCSD's members can play in advancing the conversation on coal phase out following COP26.
Well, thank you. Well, I finally made it to the presidential chair. You'll be pleased to know the gavel is safely out of reach in case I get carried away. But thank you so much. I do want to warmly congratulate President Sharma, the UK presidency, and the whole UN COP Secretariat for delivering this extraordinary event, for making COP happen, and for starting the process with such an incredible array of very practical, action-orientated, public-private, well-financed solutions that will cause, I think, the breakthroughs that enable us to breach that sub-2 degrees barrier. And it was actually that thinking, that sense of how do we create something that is really targeted, really practical, is a simple sign-up, both available for governments, but also for states, for cities, for regions, for finance agencies, for banks, and for companies, that led Catherine McKenna and I to have a really good idea in Unger in 2017. And I feel like a proud mother seeing this little baby that we brought into existence 4 years ago, basically just starting school. Imagine when this thing reaches adulthood, how much progress we'll have made in phasing out the world's most polluting fuel. And the question is a good one. What is it that businesses can bring? And I think one of the things that we're really seeing in this COP is this recognition of the public-private action that can happen together. And at the WBCSD, we've joined the PPCA as a corporate activation partner. We're an organization that represents the world's most sustainable global businesses who have to sign up to extremely stringent climate positive, nature positive, equity supporting membership criteria. And we see our role really in three areas. One is continued advocacy and support for this coal phase out. Yes, we want renewables. Yes, we see a series of transition pathways, but we need to coalesce around coal phase out and methane removal. And these are actually in items 1 and 2 in our business manifesto for climate recovery that we published yesterday. But we also think there's a huge role for knowledge sharing. One of the things we hear a lot, not in developing countries necessarily, conversations with many companies in the US, 24% of their energy system, of course, still coal-based. How do you do this? How do you actually do the grid balancing exercise? What do you do with those communities who may work in a coal-fired power station or indeed be involved in the extraction of coal? How do we make this a just transition? And we see enormous opportunities to bring our member companies like Iberdrola, who have been through this transition, to really support and advocate at the corporate level, but also to influence policy. And lastly, we think there is incredible power in the corporate supply chain. It is very, very striking. If you really want to get into some of the hardest to reach areas, regions, countries, you know, any amount of finger wagging is not going to do it. And finance clearly has an important enabling role. But if you can make a supply chain both an incentive but also a possible disincentive, having that coal-free certification for the goods and services that many of those countries want to produce and export to the world, then we're really starting to see some acceleration. And we will be working with our members on coal-free supply chain certification and delivery. So I feel incredibly proud to be here. It's just so wonderful to see this. I do want to thank the extraordinary team from the Canadian and the UK government who have kept this thing going brilliantly, and wonderful to see two new great ministers as the stewards of this going forward, and a role we think for everybody. Thank you.
Claire O'Neill from the World Business Council for Sustainable Development. Thank you very much indeed. And finally, we have James Close from NatWest here. NatWest is a major bank operating here in the UK and one of the PPCA's new members. And James, you're head of climate change.
Yes.
So what concrete actions have you taken or are you willing to take to end coal finance as part of delivering on broader pledges such as net zero targets?
Thank you very much, and congratulations to the UK and Canadian governments and all who signed up to the Powering Past Coal Alliance. And we agree that finance has a really important enabling role to play. We set out our climate strategy 18 months ago, and we said we'd get out of coal by 2030, and we'd also apply credible transition plans to all major oil and gas companies and major coal companies, and make decisions on those by the end of this year. We wanted to announce that we will be tightening that policy on coal. We'll be making it more transparent and committing to getting out by the 1st of January 2030 completely, and out of all coal in the UK by the 1st of October 2024. And in addition, we want to stop financing new customer relationships with corporates who explore for, extract or produce coal and who operate unabated coal-powered plants. We want to provide, and as part of that commitment, we're obviously joining the Powering Past Coal Alliance, and we really want to play our role along with others, both in the knowledge side of things and bringing our other colleagues in the financial sector along with us. And we think that will accelerate the inevitable and unstoppable phase-out of coal to reduce emissions and protect our precious planet. So thank you very much for inviting us here and to be part of this alliance.
James Close, Head of Climate Change at NatWest. Thank you very much indeed. Well, we are nearing the end of this event. We're not quite yet finished. So after the next speaker, please do remain seated. But for some closing remarks, I would like to now invite COP26 President Alok Sharma.
Part of our COVID secure measures on display, ladies and gentlemen, as you've just seen. Look, it's a real pleasure to join you all today to celebrate the success of the Powering Past Coal Alliance. And this alliance is absolutely central to the ambition of the UK's COP presidency. And indeed, I don't think this is an exaggeration, it is essential and central to the global energy transition. Because as I hope all of you know by now, we have been absolutely adamant that we must consign coal power to history to meet the goals of the Paris Agreement and keep 1.5 alive. We started our COP presidency aiming to end international coal financing. We started hoping to secure commitments from countries to phase out coal at home and to build up international collaboration in support of the clean energy transition. And we've also been very clear that in doing so, we must support workers and communities by creating good green jobs to fill the gap. That, for me, is vitally important. And of course, that we must also continue to expand the access to power, to improve lives, to spur development and meet our sustainable development goals. This is, of course, about clean power, but this is about individual lives and livelihoods across the world. And I met a couple of years ago a young man called Neville, who lives in Kenya. And thanks to an off-grid solar power solution providing light in the evenings, he was able to study to go to university. And this is about transforming his life so he can transform the life of his family and after that, his community. That's what this is all about. And I think the progress that has been made over the past year, the past 18 months, frankly would have seemed pretty remote when the UK took on the COP presidency. But we now know, because of the commitments that we have seen from around the world, that we are choking off international coal financing as we ramp up support for renewables. And the end of coal is absolutely in sight. At the G7 Climate and Environment Ministers meeting that I co-chaired in May, every G7 nation committed to end international coal financing this year. South Korea and China have followed, and of course we now know that the whole of the G20 has pledged to end international coal financing. That's what happens when we work together on a common goal. Now, you will have also heard a whole range of commitments that have been made by world leaders when it comes to renewables, and particularly you will have noted Prime Minister Modi's announcement that 50% of India's power is going to be generated from renewables by 2030. And a couple of days ago here at this summit, I helped to launch the Global Energy Alliance for People and Planet. It's a new £10 billion fund that will scale up to $100 billion rather by 2030. And this will support the clean energy transition, and it will partner with our COP26 Energy Transition Council that my friend Greg Hands and I work on, supporting the move to clean power in developing countries. And today we've also announced the Just Transition Declaration, signed by 14 governments and development banks. And earlier I launched the Global Coal to Clean Power Transition Statement, signed by a whole range of countries, companies and other entities as well. And of course, the new members of the Powering Past Coal Alliance that we welcome today absolutely build on this progress. 7 new countries, 7 new subnationals, and 40 new private sector and financial institutions. This is an alliance that goes from strength to strength. And together, with its 165 members, you send a really powerful message to the world that the age of coal is ending and a clean, green future awaits the world. Now, the changes that we have seen over the past couple of years, of course, are incredibly welcome. But we know that there's much more work to be done to complete that move away from coal and to expand access to power. And we will work on this during our presidency year. Greg, Kwasi, I, others will drive this from the UK as well. We also know that 750 million people worldwide still live without access to electricity. This figure, thankfully, has halved in the last decade. But there is much further to go to ensure that everyone has access to affordable, reliable, sustainable, and modern energy by 2030. And this alliance, the Powering Past Coal Alliance, has a really vital role to play in continuing to drive progress over this coming vital decade. And you do that by increasing your global membership, by sharing your experience and providing that policy support, helping countries to access renewables as they look to move away from coal. Now, look, we all understand that absolutely every single country faces unique circumstances. We all start from a different energy mix. And for some, the transition poses particular challenges. So I'm really delighted that this alliance is going to work with its partners to support those countries. And I think as Greg, Minister Hands, if I may say, said earlier, the alliance's agenda for the coming years takes into consideration those countries' needs. That's absolutely vital. The alliance will harness the support of members and partners to share experiences and best practices, and also, really importantly, it will partner with organizations like the Climate Investment Funds, the CIFs, to help countries make the transition to clean energy. And I hope you will have seen the announcements that have been made by the CIFs today as well, in terms of the countries that are going to be supported in this transition away from coal. So I wish everyone here, I wish all of the members of the alliance every success with that work. We have really come a long way with the clean energy transition, but we have to keep up the momentum, and we have to ensure that we finally kick coal into the past where it belongs. Thank you.
COP President, thank you very much indeed for your closing remarks, and thank you to all our speakers just before. Before we wrap up today's events, we're going to be hearing from the Alliance's newest private sector members who were not able to be with us here today. They've sent video messages. And we'll also be hearing from one of the Alliance's long-standing utility members, SSE, who has provided a video outlining their commitments to the Alliance.
Declaration from Ukraine. New strategy of detector in YLG brings pays special attention to decarbonization. Our company sets a goal to reach net zero carbon emission by 2040. ETEC has constructed some of the largest wind and solar power facilities in Europe. ETEC also invests in building energy storage systems and the exploration of hydrogen technology. The company Albania stands for just transition of coal mining regions and proactively participate in respective initiatives. TEC is open to cooperation with other businesses and state authorities to achieve ambitious decarbonization goals. TEC is full of energy for the great cooperation with PPCA for a greener and more sustainable future.
We took the decision over 6 years ago to transition our business out of coal. It was a decision where the societal and business strategy were in alignment. Climate risk, environmental risk and financial risk were all important factors. As early members of the Powering Past Coal Alliance, we were proud to invite COP26 President Alok Sharma to detonate the explosives at Ferry Bridge, bringing down some of the last remnants of our coal history. We've made the transition and now have one of the largest offshore wind pipelines on the planet, including building Dogger Bank, the largest offshore wind farm in the world. We've shown there is a brighter future, one without smog, without soot, without carbon. It's time to power past coal at COP26.
And that, ladies and gentlemen, brings us to the end of today's events, and this event hosted by Powering the World Past Coal. Thank you so much for joining us here today during the course of Energy Day. Today's programme has demonstrated the critical importance of energy transition to the fight against climate change. I hope that you've all been left with a sense of urgency, but also of hope. Thank you very much indeed.